¿no, sir?
Right, so we'll now, this is the last talk. When do we do vitrectomy? Endophthalmitis, rational timing and technique. So we would definitely prefer to have a goal like this rather than a disaster like that. So what are my indications for taking up a patient for endophthalmitis? How much vitrectomy? What should we avoid while doing a vitrectomy? So these are some of the risk factors which have already been covered. What are the important measures of prophylaxis has also been documented earlier. The role of intracameral antibiotics must be kept in mind, and there's a beautiful study by Dr. Haripriya et al. All of you must go through it. And I've talked to you about the glow fixator. So intravitreal injections, when not to give, when there's a coexisting retinal detachment or a choroidal detachment, when there's a virulent infection, which I showed you the indicators of what a virulent infection means, when it's a fungal endophthalmitis or the traumatic endophthalmitis, or your intravitreal injections have not worked. What is important is to do, so the options before us are a core vitrectomy, and there are certain indications where we may want to do a radical vitrectomy, which may be followed by silicone oil injection. Why do we do a vitrectomy, and how does vitrectomy work? It is because it's a material for culture. It causes reduction of toxins in organisms. It causes clearing of the media. It causes uniform antibiotic distribution. And the final fight is with, must remember that vitrectomy is not the treatment, but its final fight is with antibiotics and the body's defense mechanism. So you must rule out any other cause for immunocompromisation and diabetes mellitus. So these are the various studies which I shared. We shared with you. We should know the spectrum of organisms which is there in our country. And we should know that there's more chances of gram-negative vesicula which occur in the country. And these are basically the indications for past planar vitrectomy. When you have light perception, virulent infections, progressive course despite initial intravitreal antibiotic therapy, a delayed onset endophthalmitis, fungal endophthalmitis, recurrent infections, endophthalmitis with RD, choroidal detachment, traumatic endophthalmitis, and when you don't get a view on the endothelial ophthalmoscopy, or when there's a pacification of the vitreous or there's a macular pucker. We have already elucidated on how to take a sample. So just to show you, I'll rapidly run through the video. You may not be able to see the inside, so you can put in an AC maintainer. You should always, if you have a pupillary membrane, try to remove the pupillary membrane, because that way your visibility is going to improve. Otherwise, you'll do a blind vitrectomy. Blind vitrectomy is definitely not indicated. So you should go in, and if you find a pupillary membrane, you'll be surprised. I've had, in all these years, I've had two times when I had planned a vitrectomy, there was a minimal reaction. I removed the pupillary membrane. I found the media to be reasonably clear. I did not do vitrectomy in that case and gave an intravitreal injection. But those are rare situations, because when you have decided on vitrectomy, you will probably end up doing that. So basically, the membrane has been removed, and then you go ahead and put in an infusion cannula, which usually in such case, this is an older video where we had to put a sutured cannula. So we put in a 6 mm infusion cannula. We try to identify the tip, and then we go ahead and do the vitrectomy as much as possible without trying to induce a PVD, and then give intraocular antibiotics. This is again another patient where a core vitrectomy is done. We are able to visualize the retina. Do not try to induce a PVD. Most of the MIVS cutters are work pretty well. So this is just to show you how vitrectomy works pretty well till you are able to see the disc and vessels, and that is it. So then you can go ahead. So these are some of the examples of cases. This is a patient with P. acnes. So in P. acnes, we do something certain as a little differently. We, after doing a vitrectomy, we make an opening on the posterior capsule, and then we cause an irrigation of the bag, and which makes sure that all the organisms which are there within the bag drop into the vitreous, go back into the vitreous once more, and clean it up again, and then we inject vancomycin intracamerally, and we found that patients generally do pretty well. Fungal endophthalmitis, as I told you, the eyes are more signs than symptoms. So these cases should be taken up for vitrectomy. So you do an EC wash vitrectomy, intravitreal injection of voriconazole with an intracameral injections, and many of these cases may require an intraocular lens explantation. But if we try to save the lens most often, if we can, but if we can't, then it has to be removed. So these are some of the cases who did well. Just to show you, this is a case of fungal endophthalmitis. I'll skip this. So this is courtesy Dr. Das. Just wanted to show you, this is a 77-year-old male who presented with total loss of vision for 3 days after cataract surgery. So this is just to show that you should not give up in such cases. So looking at this, most people would have said, iska kya karna chhod do, this eye is going to become thysical. So this is a reported case. It is a case of Pseudomonas aeruginosa, vitrectomy done, IOL explantation, intravitreal amikacin, vancomycin, dexamethasone, oral ciprofloxacin, and the patient did well. Dr. Subhadra is there, she would probably know about this case. So endophthalmitis with retinal detachment, this is uncommon, but if it occurs, some people sometimes decide never to operate. This case we normally do, and this is one case, one indication where we do a radical vitrectomy. We may end up creating a few breaks. We try to avoid them, and then we inject silicone oil, laser photocoagulation, and intraocular antibiotic injections, which can be given within the silicone oil itself. In a case where you have a corneal perforation, you might want to put in a keratoplasticus, do a partial and a vitrectomy, followed by a therapeutic PK, and then you end up doing later on, if everything goes well, you can do an optical graft. This was reported by Dr. Patange. This was a case where I just wanted to share with you, which I have not used it, but they have used in a traumatic case. They have given IVTA on the fourth day. The patient has staph epidermidis and did well, because sometimes it's very scary to use steroids, particularly IVTA in these cases. But yes, it's been used and reported. As I told you earlier, whenever you have an infection following Avastin on the Ozodex, it requires an urgent vitrectomy and must be taken up urgently. So these are some of the interesting cases. This is a 45-year-old type 2 diabetic, intravitreal Avastin given, vitreous hemorrhage post-op day 1. Patient had vitrectomy, intravitreal injection, vancomycin given. Sent for microbe. 48 hours later, patient's hyperopia is back. Patient had a re-wit, vanco anemica given. And patient then goes for a second opinion, undergoes a second re-wit with voriconazole. The sample was sent for PCR. And at this stage, after PCR, what we grew was Bacteroides fragilis. And the patient responded. Patient was treated well, and patient responded. So this is another patient who had vancomycin. Again, was micro-negative, hypopin increased. The sample was sent for PCR and given linezolid. The Pseudomonas aeruginosa responded to colistin. So why I'm trying to show, what I'm trying to share with you, organismal diagnosis in endophthalmitis is very, very important. When you take a vitreous stab, there's a 60% yield. When you take an echo stab, there's about a 40% yield. But you must strive for getting an organismal diagnosis. In this series of PGI cases, this is slides from Dr. Vaishali. I just wanted to show how important it was. It was a catastrophe of 30 eyes who received intravitreal Avastin. And on the post-op the day 1, on the smear, they showed gram-negative bacilli. So they cannot get a culture. So the first time in the history of PGI, they tried a test called MALDI-TOF, and which they got a report within 3 hours, and it showed that they had an organism which was sensitive to ceftazidime, levoflox, cotrimoxazole, and minocycline. And this is what MALDI-TOF is. MALDI means matrix assisted laser desorption ionization, and TOF stands for time of flight spectrometry. So these, they had two types of presentation, task-like presentation, hyperopia, vitritis, and most of these eyes could be saved because of this test. and this organism or tropophomonas maltophila, which they had 11 eyes which showed this, 7 eyes were culture positive, 6 out of 7 culture positive patients had vitritis like picture, only one eye was lost, most of the cases responded well. This is some of the newer antibiotics which you must know, especially the postgraduates, and you must know that they what they are used for. The take-home message is consider early vitrectomy, always take vitreous sample for grams, pKa and culture. AC management is important for removing the papillary membrane, and if required, fill in the AC with viscoelastic. Always use a good cutter. Invariably, it is said, ye to end of ka kaisa purana cutter nikal ke laga lo, so that is not fair. Use a 6 mm infusion cannula. If you cannot visualize the infusion cannula, so you have a sutured cannula. In routine case, debulking of the vitreous is adequate. You must, the end point should be visibility of the disc and the vessels. Do not try to induce a PVD. But if the PVD is there, yes, you can do as much vitrectomy as possible. In case one needs to go close to the retina, try to reduce suction. Thank you, and thank you, Himantri, for this wonderful opportunity. Yes, sir, please. Same site means? Right. So you could do that, because what he showed was you put in a cannula with the infusion cannula, you have taken the cutter, then I would probably put in a small little bubble so that there is now regurgitation, go beyond the bubble and inject and then remove the cannula. Or I would after doing the cutter, I would remove that and go through a separate site and then inject the antibiotics. So what is important is the vanco and septa can form a coagulum. So what is important is in the post-injection period, when you do an ultrasound, you might find a coagulum. Do not consider it to be a fungal infection. We've had cases where an ultrasound is done, you find a coagulum, you say, "Arey, isko to fungal ho gaya, voriconazole inject karo." But you must know that they can react and form a coagulum. And it works. The coagulum also works. Yeah, the coagulum works. Yeah. Anything, madam? Aap bataye. We are very fortunate Dr. Subhadra is here.
Really, thank you so much, ma'am, for being a part of this session. This is my passion. Just 5 points I wanted to say. The management of non-infectious endophthalmitis, we have published in JCRS in 1995 when I was a fellow. And I think that's the only article which tells you that how to manage that case where you think I'm not going to intervene. So because there are so many cases we don't intervene, how to manage that and what's the correct protocol? That is in JCRS. If you can't find it, you can email to me. The other thing is, we keep on saying that, you know, in USA and all, they don't have gram negative. I think whenever we put the TVS data, we must put an asterisk and say that they excluded all the eyes with cornean involvement, because their entry criteria was cornea should be clear enough clear to do a good vitrectomy. So that is why in EVS, the gram negative are less. So it's not that they don't get gram negative, but that is not a real world data. So a large majority of those patients got excluded. So I think we should put that there. The other thing is that we have this e-kit by Aurolab, which has all the drugs already given in the correct dilution. So you don't have to, you know, struggle. So one or two kits of these we always keep in our rural centers, because there are a lot of doctors. They may not know the protocols. So this e-kit, it is by Aurolab. It is available. It's very cost effective. So you don't have to buy a full vial of, you know, vanco or septa and all these drugs and waste your money. It's already allocated, and that required a lot of hard work with the DGCI to get it done. So it's done for all of us. So I think we should use it. The other thing is that the PL, when we say, you know, that vitrectomy has to be done by PL only eyes, the definition of PL, all of us should know, in EVS, PL only eyes were eyes where there was not hand movements at 1 meter. That is the definition of PL only eyes. So we have to check hand movement at 1 meter, and anybody who does not have hand movement at 1 meter goes for vitrectomy. That is the definition of PL only eyes. It's not the way we check PLPR. And the last thing is that now we also have endoscopic vitrectomy, and that has already been published by Vivek Dave. Those who have access to that, that's a very good option in cases the media is hazy, whether it's traumatic or post-corneal ulcer or perforation. So we don't always need to go through temporary keratoprocesses. It's a very good outcome with endoscopic vitrectomy, with or without oil. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you
but
so much.
But eventually, after this endoscopy, you will have to go in for the corneal transplant at some point of time.
Ma'am, my only question is, ma'am, in endoscopic vitrectomy, how do you evaluate whether the patient is improving or not?
Ultrasound.
So one would be ultrasound, but also the intraocular pressure and the other signs and symptoms. And of course, the corneal ulcer you are anyway treating. So you will also evaluate whether the infectious keratitis is improved or not. But it gives you a window of opportunity where you don't have to do a graft in an eye. Suppose during endoscopic vitrectomy, you find all the retinas detached and it's very bad. Why waste a graft? Or, you know, you are not doing in an inflamed eye, so you can do an optical PK later on if the cornea heals, you know. So that's the advantage. You don't do, and even sometimes to do a therapeutic graft in an eye with the corneal ulcer, like infectious keratitis with endophthalmitis, you may have to do a very big graft. Finally, you may have to do a smaller graft, even if it's therapeutic, but if a lot of things are healed, then you can do.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
I thank you, each and every one of you, to be a part of this so much interactive session. It was a pleasure having you all, even if it is the fourth day of the conference. I really appreciate and especially mention Shubhadra Jalani ma'am for being an expert in this session. Thank you so much, ma'am, and also thanks to all the audience who have been very interactive, and it was a very good session. Thank you very much. And we hope to meet you all in AIOC Kolkata as part of the Northeast India. I'd like to invite each one of you as part of the extended LOC. Please come and be a part of AIOC 2021.